You know, not so very long ago at all, it was the mark of an environmental visionary to say something like this. Forget about peak oil. Forget about running out of fossil fuels or arable land or any of a number of critical minerals or agricultural commodities. The real resource problem of the future, the one that will divide nations and drive wars, is water. Now the world's water problems are in the news all the time, and sometimes even on the front page or at the top of the newscast where they belong. And these are serious problems of water quality, but also water quantity. And they are not all off in the future. It seems likely at this very moment, for example, that regions of the earth holding two-thirds of the world's people, including portions of the American Southwest, experience severe water shortages for at least 1 month of the year. By severe shortage, we mean having only half as much water as is needed for household, agricultural, and industrial use. That's 4 billion people we're talking about. And 500 million of them experience serious water shortages in every month of the year. In Minnesota, until fairly recently, we have taken water quantity for granted while reserving our concern and our public policy efforts mostly for issues of water quality. These are the issues that form the driving force behind the special dedicated sales tax that we voted on to ourselves in hopes of creating a legacy. But that is changing too as we begin to realize that having as much water as we want, whenever we want, for whatever use we wish to put it to, is no longer guaranteed. And there is no better person on earth to talk about the sustainability of Minnesota's water resource than Dr. Deborah Swackhamer, our speaker tonight. She led the process that produced the state's policy framework for water sustainability, is the chief author, I guess we would say, of that very large document. Before retiring this past summer, she held two appointments at the University of Minnesota, professor of science, technology, and public policy at the Humphrey Institute, and professor of environmental health sciences in the School of Public Health. Also, for a dozen years, she directed the Water Resources Center at the U. She began as a chemist, earning a BA in chemistry from Grinnell College in Iowa, then an MS in water chemistry from the University of Wisconsin at Madison, and then a PhD in limnology and oceanography, also from Madison. Her research work has been focused on public health issues at the intersection of water and toxicology, studying a wide range of environmental poisons from mercury and arsenic to endocrine disruptors. She is also active at the crossroads of water science and public policy with too many important appointments really to list, but here are a few. Chair of the Board of Scientific Counselors for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, a role she continues in her post-university retirement. Past member of the Science Advisory Board of the International Joint Commission of the U.S. and Canada, which not everyone here may recognize as the consultative body that oversees waters along the international border, and continuing service on the Board of Environmental Science and Toxicology at the National Academy of Sciences. I've known Deb through my journalism work for something like 15 years now, and I believe she has a unique gift for explaining science to non-scientists with great patience and enthusiasm, without oversimplification and nary a trace of condescension. I am personally grateful to her for teaching me how to pronounce phthalates. Because she's keeping up a busy schedule as a speaker on issues of water sustainability at local, regional, and national gatherings, we should feel honored that she's making this time for us tonight. She'll talk for about a half hour, and then we'll open it up for questions. And the way we're going to do that, just to make it smoother, is you can write your questions on the index cards on your table, hold them up, and then Sally Waterman, our advertising director, and Bethany Hollenkamp, our office manager, will be circulating and collecting. They'll bring them up here, and I'll try to sort them into some sort of order, and we'll go from there. So now, just please join me in a warm welcome for Dr. Deb Swackhamer.
Thank you. Wow, what an introduction. I have a lot to live up to with all of that. So, land of 10,000 lakes, water everywhere. Everything on that map that's blue is water. We have more water than any of the other 48 states in the lower 48. More surface water than any other state. It's a big responsibility, it's a big gift, it's wonderful. But that's a lot of water. So water, water everywhere. What are we talking about? What's the problem? Well, is it going to be enough water? And that's a big question. So enough water means the map shows where people are going to be living by 2040. We're going to be over 6 million people in this state by 2030. And so those people are going to be moving around and living in different places, and that's going to put different stresses on our water system. We also know that our population is aging. So that's our growth, and then this is our aging. So anyone in the room that's over 55, we're going to start to be the majority here pretty soon. So that's going to change everything from the tax income in the state to water use in the state. So that's kind of a big deal. And then you can have all the water in the world, but if it isn't clean, you've still got a big problem. So do we have enough water that's clean enough? So this map of Minnesota, everything that is orange and red means that that water does not meet the water quality standards for the state of Minnesota or the federal government. We're out of compliance with federal law. All the water that is yellow, kind of gold, and red. So guess what? Minnesota has lots of water, but a lot of it is in trouble from a quality perspective. So we have lots of impaired waters. We have 40% of the waters in Minnesota, the surface waters in Minnesota, do not meet federal and state water quality standards. Turns out that's an average for the nation, but we like to be above average, right? So we would like that number to change. So in Minnesota, we're actually very lucky. We are the only state in the union that has a definition of water sustainability in our statutes. So the legislature back in 2009 actually put the definition of sustainable water use into statute, and that is the language. There's some important things here. We include both ecosystems in the definition, not just people. And we don't say we need enough water for our grandchildren or for seven generations. It's all future generations. This is a very big deal. So Minnesota has a very aspirational definition, but it's a really good one. And we're the only state that has it in statute. It's also important to appreciate, It's important to appreciate that we're not just talking about water as an environmental issue. We need to consider the social issues around water, the cultural issues around water, the economic issues around water. To have sustainable water management in the state of Minnesota, it's not just about the environment. It's about finding the intersection of both social needs, economic needs, and environmental needs. And that's a really important point. So we have addressed sustainability. As Ron mentioned, I had the pleasure of leading the effort to develop the Minnesota Water Sustainability Framework. And the background of that is that we have a definition in statute. We didn't have to fight over that. That was good. We passed the Water Legacy Act, which created the concept of a clean water fund. And then, of course, we passed the Clean Water Land and Legacy Amendment to our Constitution, which put money into that fund to the tune of about $125 million a year for 25 years. $125 million a year for 25 years dedicated to clean water. It can't be reappropriated. Well, back when it was created, it was $100 million a year, but because of our success as an economy in the state, it's up to about $125. We created the Minnesota Sustainability Framework. It was a huge collective effort. About 250 people put this thing together. Every water expert in the state, I think, was consulted. It was a wonderful effort, and the bottom line was we chose the highest bar for what we wanted to say was acceptable for Minnesota. We didn't take the lowest common denominator in our recommendations. We took the highest bar. And it's a 25-year plan to protect and conserve and enhance the quality and quality of the state's groundwater and surface water for both ecosystem use and human use. So that was our mandate from the legislature, and the legislature was then in turn happy to get the Minnesota water sustainability framework. So what were the issues that the framework, and this is the framework here, what were the issues that we identified? Well, first let me preface that with saying that all of the issues that we identified are all national issues. Minnesota is like a microcosm of the country. Every issue we face here could be listed as a national issue from a number of other studies. So what Minnesota does is actually watched by every other state in the country, most other states in the country, and certainly the federal government. Water quantity. We need to make sure we have a sustainable supply of clean water. Water quality, and there are several issues to be dealt with here: excess nutrients, conventional pollutants, and contaminants of emerging concern. We have land and water connections, and this is basically how water intersects with land use and how it intersects with energy use. And then we have economic issues, such as water pricing and infrastructure, and then we have some governance aspects of water management. So these were all identified by our 250 experts, and in fact, those are all issues that get discussed at the national level. So when I talked about infrastructure, for instance, if you've heard of Flint, Michigan, you may not have heard of Flint, Michigan prior to about 6 months ago, but that's an infrastructure issue, and that's an example where another state, and it's now it's recognized as a federal problem, we face here in Minnesota. So one thing I want to point out is how connected these issues are. I present them as a list, as if it's one kind of a laundry list, and if you just addressed each one in turn, you could check them off and you'd be fine. But the thing is that they're actually influenced by so many factors. So we have four overriding factors that affect our water quality and quantity, and that is climate and how it changes, demographics, how many people and where they live, energy, how much energy we're using, because that's very connected to water use, and land use, and that's very connected to water use. And these are all interconnected, because if you have more people, you need more energy. If you have a warmer climate, you need more energy, et cetera. All these things interrelate. Then you add some of the water issues that I just mentioned, and they are all interrelated to those drivers, but they're also interrelated to each other. None of these is an isolated issue that you can isolate, fix, and say, there we go, I got one out of six. We can move on to number two. They're all interrelated. And they're very much affected by social choices and economic choices, social well-being and economic health. So these things are all a system. They're not a laundry list of these are the things we need to worry about in the state. It's a system. Our water system is connected to our economic system and our social structure. All right, now let's talk about those issues. I'm going to go through these issues pretty quickly, and I hope they spur questions for you, because I'm not going to be able to talk about everything, because Ron's going to start to throw things at me. And let's start with water supply. A lot of people in Minnesota are very surprised that this is an issue, or that I mention it first. They think, hey, you just told us we have more water than anybody else. What's the problem? The problem is, we're using lots of groundwater. So in Minnesota, and actually this is in the metro area only, but I'll address the rest of the state in a minute. In the metro area over the last 60 years, we've gone from using mostly surface water, 90% surface water back in the 40s and 50s, and now our water supply is provided, the surface water only provides about 25% of our water supply. The rest is being supplied by groundwater. So we've increased the amount, the percentage of groundwater and the amount of groundwater that we're using for our water supply in the metro area. Why is this? Well, as we built those suburbs and those seven counties got bigger and bigger and fuller of people, they dug wells. It was a lot easier to dig a well and get clean groundwater than it was to pipe water from the Mississippi or for the way Minneapolis and St. Paul always have and continue to do so. But now the population is dominated by these suburban communities that use groundwater. What's the problem with that? Well, the thing is that groundwater, you run out of it, and it doesn't get replenished in the same time frame that surface water does. Our surface water gets replenished every time it rains. Our surface water comes from the sky. Snow, rain, that's where we get our water. It comes all the time, once a week, twice a week. And groundwater, it takes hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of years to replace the groundwater. So often people liken surface water use to like spending from a checking account, and using your groundwater is like spending on a savings account. And that's what's been happening in the Twin Cities. As a result, this is a hydrograph. This shows the level of the groundwater monitored by the DNR at a site out by Lake Minnetonka that they have data from the 40s. Steady decline in that groundwater. It's not coming back in the time frame that we're using it. So this is unsustainable by definition. We're using way more than we can replace. Now, in the metro area, the Met Council has done modeling to show the vulnerabilities of our groundwater system in the future. So if we continue on this path, the red areas show we will have less than 50% of the water supply by 2030. That's not sustainable. We're going to run out of water in the metro if we don't do something about how we're using groundwater. So enough said about this. I just want to say that there are issues with water supply, even in Minnesota. And I don't have a map here, but I can tell you that there are dozens of areas around the state where this is happening. Wells are running dry. And it's not just the metro area. This is not just a metro problem. It is a state problem. So what can we do to fix this? So for each of these issues, I'm going to put up some strategies. I don't want to just make you all depressed and have you keep drinking and crying into your beer. We don't want to have that happen. And I'm going to also say whether the state is doing something positive or, you know, I'm going to give the state some grades, basically. So the state has established groundwater management areas. They have developed water balance models, such as the one I showed you for the metro. They are revising the permit system, which is long overdue. I can talk about that later if you like. And they are determining minimum ecosystem flows. How much water do you need in a stream or a river to protect the ecosystem? Not just human use, but fish and invertebrates, et cetera. And what is the state doing? They're doing all of these things. So they're heading in the right direction. The state heard these issues loud and clear, and they have embarked at the state level to fix them. Okay, now let's move to water quality, what most people think is our biggest problem, which we can argue what's most important, but they're all kind of important. So water quality issues, there are really two big categories. There's the conventional pollutants, which include excess nutrients. So some nutrient is good. Nutrients, you're having nutrients right now. But if you have too much of them, there's that whole problem of weight gain, and that's what's happened with some of our lakes and rivers. Too many nutrients, so that's not healthy for them. And then conventional pollutants. So the top bullet really refers to those pollutants that are regulated. They're covered under existing law. The next one is contaminants of emerging concern that I'll talk about, and those are basically unregulated pollutants. And unfortunately, there's many, many more. Hundreds more of them than there are the conventional pollutants. So that really creates a bit of a management problem because we don't have a legal structure to manage them. So excess nutrients, they drive the impaired waters problem. So all those waters I showed that are out of compliance with federal and state law, they're considered impaired. That's a legal term. Excess nutrients and bacteria are the two biggest drivers in Minnesota, and by the way, in the nation, of impaired waters. So that's that map again. So where do they come from? They come from agricultural practice, from development in suburban areas, and from increased stormwater as a result of that development. In terms of the sources, we have both phosphorus and nitrogen sources, and I'll simply interpret this for you. But the idea is that more than half of the sources of both phosphorus and nitrogen, the two nutrients of concern, more than half are coming from agricultural practice, mostly from row crops. And so Minnesota, as a very major farming state, does have a problem also with generating excess nutrients as a result of that great productivity. Phosphorus causes eutrophication. That's the problem with things like Lake Pepin. That's the problem with things like the algal blooms that you see in, say, Lake Minnetonka, with the southeast and southwestern part of the state. Lots of green stuff growing in the water by the time you reach midsummer. That's excess algae being created by excess phosphorus. But perhaps of even greater concern is excess nitrates, which are also coming from agriculture. And excess nitrates are a public health concern. We have a health standard under the Safe Drinking Water Act that protects health. But the point is that excess nitrates can kill babies under the age of 6 months if they're exposed to water above that standard. It can kill them. And so this is a serious public health threat It's not just, oh, we have green stuff growing in our lakes. You know, you potentially have some impaired children. This particular map shows the presence of excess nitrate in private wells in the state. The red are where those wells violate that public health standard. All the red. And the orange means it's getting close. So we have a big problem in this state with nitrate pollution. So what can the state do? Actually, the state has done a whole bunch of things, okay? They have been monitoring at the watershed scale, so they've developed a whole new monitoring plan to manage our regulated pollutants and to try to address them. They are pursuing something called WRAPs, Watershed Restoration and Protection Strategies. Whoever has heard of this or knows about them, raise your hand. Looking for some level of how much to explain. Okay, you can ask me during the break or whatever. Watershed, this is basically the plan for fixing what they find when they assess the waters. And they're doing this for every watershed in the state. So we have a great plan. We have one of the best plans in the country. I would say we have the best plan in the country for addressing, trying to figure out how much of our water is impaired and how to fix it. We have a water quality certification program through the Department of Agriculture that says if you farmer, if you do the right thing, we're going to give you a certification. That's cool. We have a nutrient reduction strategy at the state level. Very ambitious. This is a terrific plan, and it calls for a 40% reduction of nitrogen in the state by, I think it's 2040, 2045, something like that. And we have a Minnesota nitrogen fertilizer management plan coming out of the Department of Agriculture to address the similar issues. So we're doing a whole bunch of stuff, lots of plans, lots of monitoring, lots of this, that, and the other. And we also have, of course, the Governor's Buffer Initiative. That's what's down there. Ron, could you just move that chair? Here we go, in case anybody is looking at that bottom piece there. So we've done a bunch of things. Now, are they working? Well, yep, the monitoring, we got, like I said, best program in the country. The watershed, the WRAPS approach is a great idea. We have to wait and see how it's going to go. So it gets a question mark, but it's definitely heading in the right direction. Water quality certification, it gets a yellow only because it's voluntary. So it means the good farmers do this, but the bad farmers don't. And we don't really know even if the good farmers improve water quality. There's not really a way to connect those two. So, question mark. The Minnesota Reduction Strategy is a great idea, but they haven't really said how they're going to meet that 40% reduction. Huge, huge goal there. And then the fertilizer management plan, same thing. It's going to take a whole lot of political will to actually make that come to pass. And then the buffer initiative, definitely in the right direction. Okay. We think. Now, are they working? Are these all this stuff that they're doing at the state level, is it working? Well, the problem is phosphorus might be going down. Nitrates are going up. All of this effort on nitrates, and nitrates continue to increase in the state. I'm not going to explain that graph other than to say we're not meeting those reduction goals that the state has set out. If we were to meet the reduction goals, it would require drastic changes on our landscape. We would have to change some of what is grown in the state of Minnesota. We would have to change some of our agricultural systems. That's a big disruptive change. That's not like let's use a little less nitrogen on our corn. We're talking about changing what is grown on the land. Big changes. So other strategies that we're not doing that are possible. So I want to leave you with some hope here. You could require that those WRAPs get implemented, those plans for how to restore and protect our water, make them required to be done. Right now, they're just a plan. They don't have to be done. Make them required. Provide for equity. Guess who's not at the table from a regulatory standpoint? Row crop agriculture is exempted under the Clean Water Act. And so we don't have an equity between stormwater, cities that have to comply with stormwater rules, or wastewater utilities that have to comply with wastewater effluents, and agriculture, which doesn't have to comply with anything. And so it's a lack of equity. I'm not picking on farmers. I'm saying our regulatory structure lacks equity with a major source. go beyond the farmers. It's not, those farmers get, yeah, they get picked on all the time. I'm not here to beat on farmers. It's a system. They're businessmen. They're just, and women. They're doing what they do because it's a business. But they have supply chains. And guess what? Supply chains are very powerful. The Walmarts of the world have changed a whole lot of what goes on in environmental policy, and it's because they have supply chains, and they can say, I'm not going to buy your product if it's wrapped in this plastic with phthalates in it. There's that word again, Ron. Go to the food companies. Talk to Cargill. Talk to ADM. Talk to different parts of the food supply. Don't just pick on the farmers. In fact, they don't get to set their prices. Guess who does? The Farm Bill sets the price for their product. It's not a free market. So work on the Farm Bill. The Farm Bill actually is the overarching policy that affects all of the things to do with water and agriculture. And I can talk about that later if you like to. So move on to contaminants of emerging concern. There's hundreds of unregulated, potentially toxic chemicals in our water supply. They come from all over the place. They come from food containers. They come from our household products. They come from makeup and household consumer goods. They come from agricultural livestock veterinarian pharmaceuticals that are used for livestock. They come from our own pharmaceuticals that get into the water supply, both from excretion as well as from improper disposal. And the effects are huge. We know that many of these kinds of chemicals affect human reproduction, affect development and growth of our children. They affect and contribute to heart disease and diabetes and obesity, those epidemics you hear about all the time. These are contributors to that. They're like triggers for those kinds of epidemics. And we know that they affect not just whoever is exposed, they affect the children of those that are exposed. So this is a big problem. There we go. So I should have been clicking all that time. So we know that they affect reproduction, development, these epidemics to do with other health diseases, and then they affect the next generation. Even if it was mom that was exposed, she doesn't have the problem. It's her children that show up with the problems. So these are insidious problems, very difficult to regulate because we don't have a clear cause-effect relationship. But we do know this much about them. And there's hundreds of these chemicals, and yes, they are found in our groundwater and our surface water here in Minnesota. So we're expanding our drinking water protection at the state level. Our state is a leader in this. We have put into play through the Department of Health protection for drinking water. And so that is that gets a good arrow. In order to get these chemicals out of our consumer products and out of our waste stream, we need some better policies around putting these chemicals in the first place. And that's called green chemistry, using safer chemicals to make the same products, substituting toxic chemicals with safer chemicals. And in Minnesota, we actually have a nexus of companies that do this. But they're kind of doing it on their own. And actually, frankly, if the state were to really invest in, say, some kind of tax incentives, those kinds of things to help promote those chemical companies in the state, we would actually do so much better. But we would need to really create sort of a green chemistry sector where we have, say, a medical products, medical device kind of sector. So for us to go there, those industries need some help to coordinate and get some benefits for making those investments. Okay, water connections to other media. So we know that water is connected to land. Any water that falls on the land runs to a river or a stream, and it's picked up the footprint, if you will. It's picked up everything that it saw on the land. So our water starts completely clean from the sky, and it falls on the land, and it picks up soil, and it picks up nutrients, and it picks up pharmaceuticals, and it picks up all sorts of stuff and then runs into a river, and then the river is polluted. So our land use is critical to understanding water pollution. Land use planning is typically done at the zoning level, at the township level. Water planning is done at the county level on a completely different time frame, and yet they're interrelated. So a simple thing to do, relate the two. Require land and water planning to be done at the same scale, same geographic scale, and the same time scale. And you get a lot of bang for your buck, and that wouldn't cost very much. We also have to worry about habitat and ecological integrity, and I'll talk about that, hydrologic integrity, and the connection to energy. So I already mentioned how land How we use the land affects water. And one of the things to do is to integrate that planning. And the state is working on this through something called One Watershed, One Plan. It's in its infant stages, and it isn't clear whether that effort is going to actually result in improvements or not, but it's a good first start. Ecological integrity. So this includes things like everything from endangered species to invasive species. So it has to do with protecting priority habitat for aquatic species, managing and making sure that these aquatic invasives do not continue to invade. We have more than 150 invasive species, aquatic invasive species in Minnesota. That's a lot to manage, but that's what we're up against. And then dealing with climate adaptation strategies. Lots of meetings on this, lots of talk about this. Not much is actually getting done around this. And so if you recall some of the flooding that took place, for instance, in Duluth, that's an example of where climate change adaptation is happening after they've already seen the effect of floods. And then conserving marginal lands. So hydrologic integrity, we need to worry about tile drainage. And so we're not the only state that does tiling. This is a map of tile drainage for the whole country. We're just part of the problem. We're not the whole problem, but you can see Minnesota's got quite a bit of tile drainage going on. And this is a vector, a transport mechanism for those nitrates and phosphorus and bacteria to get into our water from farm fields. We need to slow the movement of water off the land. You know, we tiled to drain water off this great farmland and move it quickly into ditches so that it could go to streams and rivers. And that was all good back in the 50s and 100 years ago even. But now we recognize there's a downside, a big cost to have paid in doing that. So we need to slow that water down. No one that I know of is advocating for putting back in all those wetlands and tearing out the tile drains. It's a matter of managing those tile drains in a way that slows down the water and removes those pollutants before they get into our major waterways. And then climate adaptation, this is what I was talking about. Here's a picture from Duluth, the great flood of 2012. Stormwater, this is a great example of a stormwater project for an entire city that is in Minnesota that has looked at how to manage and slow the movement of water off the land so that that stormwater is treated on site, and you don't have to build a water treatment plant. You can just put in all sorts of various, very pretty kinds of systems that will manage that water. The water energy nexus. This is one, a lot of people kind of, they scratch their heads. They're like, what is she talking about here? Well, it turns out that we use, well, here's a little quiz. So what is the biggest use of water in Minnesota? If I said answer A is to generate electricity, about three of you would raise your hand. But that's the right answer. 67% of the water use in Minnesota is to cool the cooling towers of our electricity plants. 67%. Now that water is once passed through right back in the rivers, but still, that's our biggest use of water. So that means that every time we turn on a light, you're using water. And you have to appreciate that although it's not polluting that water necessarily, it's using that water and it's making it warmer and it has an impact. So every time you turn on a light, you're using Minnesota water, just so you know. So making you feel guilty. Okay, I've gone from making you feel depressed. Now I'm doing the guilt thing. All right, we're gonna end up on a hopeful note, don't worry. We use water, we use energy to clean our water. That's the Metro Wastewater Treatment Plant. Tons of energy goes into cleaning our water. So that's another connection. And of course, in Minnesota and Iowa, we care about biofuels and ethanol and corn being used for liquid fuel. And so water is used, a tremendous amount of water is used to make ethanol, which is a big deal here in this state and our neighboring states. So there's a huge connection between water and energy. Don't for a minute think that those are two independent issues and you can have energy policy over here and, oh yeah, over here you can have water policy. They're all connected. So what is Minnesota doing? Well, we have coordinated land and water planning, kind of. It's this one watershed, one plan concept is a good one. We'll wait and see if it actually works. Protecting priority habitat and managing aquatic invasive species, we're in the right direction. We have a new aquatic invasive species center at the University of Minnesota. The DNR really is on top of the science there. It's whether they have the manpower and the funding to actually prevent invasive species. We are working a little bit on climate change. As I said, lots of meetings, a lot of talk. Communities are doing some work, but I don't see a lot of action at the state level. And even at the federal level, they're producing tools for communities to use. They're very anxious to help. But I just hear a lot of talk. I actually haven't seen a lot of investment in these strategies. So, conserving marginal lands. We're actually doing a pretty good job there because of the, basically through the Lessard Sams Outdoor Heritage Fund, we actually can set aside some of these marginal lands and conserve lands. And in terms of slowing movement off the land and aligning our water and energy policy, big downward arrow. We're doing nothing for these two issues. Nothing. Waiting for people to go, ah. Okay. Now let me finish up with talking about that last set of issues. So, aging infrastructure, as I mentioned. Normally this, everybody yawns, goes to sleep. But Flint, Michigan has made aging infrastructure like the buzzword of the week. We all know about the Flint problem, and I'm happy to answer questions about that as well. But I'll simply say, we have the same aging infrastructure. We don't have the same problems that led to Flint from an economic and governance perspective, but we have the same infrastructure problem that Flint still has. Optimizing the pricing of water. What you pay for your water doesn't come close to what it costs to actually have you have that water. None of us pay the true cost of water. We pay for it externally through our various taxes for the Clean Water Fund, for our wastewater treatment. We pay for it in other ways, but we don't pay for the actual cost of water. We're used to paying a fraction of what we should pay. Educating and engaging the public. This is a social issue. Well, I'm kind of dedicated to that myself. This is why I talk to groups like this. I feel very strongly that the more people know, the more they stop and think. When you go home tonight and you flip on that light switch, most of you will go, "Oh, Deb said, oh, I'm using water," you know? It's not a bad thing. It's just that you need to know they're connected. So, aligning our public policies. I would love to see the state make an incredible, strong investment in this. Not just doing water policy, not just doing energy policy, which we have a pretty good energy policy, but it ignores water. Transportation, all these things are connected, and it would be wonderful if the state were to sit down and say, which of these policies are working against each other? And I'll tell you right now, the transportation policy and water policy are working against each other. Okay, infrastructure. I'll just give you an example because we do know the numbers in Minnesota. This is simply a five-year horizon from 2015 to 2019. This shows the needs projected for the state of Minnesota, and this shows the available funding at both the state and federal level, of which there is a lot of federal money, and the state has been pretty generous at matching that and coming up with ways. But you see, this is the gap. That's the gap in billions of dollars. So over a 20-year period, Minnesota needs about $10 billion to fix just its aging water infrastructure. Now, the governor actually has put forward in his bonding bill, which we'll hear about once the session opens, a plan to fill that gap. And it's a pretty good plan. It's a smart plan. But we're the only state that has one? Really? Yes, we're the only state that has put forward a plan of how to fill that gap. And the federal government, the president's budget that just was released last week, decreases this pot of federal money, not increases. Yeah. So it's a good thing that we have a governor that's actually thinking about how to fill that gap. But it's a big gap. We're talking billions of dollars. At the federal level, it's about $10 trillion to address drinking water and wastewater infrastructure problems. And now we know that the problems do lead to something. Again, Flint, Michigan. Okay, so we also need a bunch of changes around our social and economic practices, I guess is the best way to say it. We need to make sure that each of us is responsible for our water, where it comes from and where it goes. We want to, I'd love to push for real water pricing in this state, but in communities that have tried to do that have been badly beaten back by the citizens of those communities saying, "Hey, I'm used to paying, you know, pennies for my water. How dare you ask me to pay nickels? No, I'm not going to do it." So these referenda get voted down all the time. So that's something for you to think about in your own local communities. We need an effective policy framework, not a collection of oddball things. As I mentioned, if you don't approach this as a system, you won't get nearly the bang for your buck. We need to train people on the next generation, and we need to align these policies. The last point I want to make is that Minnesota has a huge responsibility. We're the only state that starts with completely clean water. We don't import any water. Rivers don't flow into Minnesota. They flow out of Minnesota. Other places don't have that luxury. We, in fact, are the headwaters for the three largest water systems in North America. Three. I'm not sure there's more than three. No, there is. There's the Columbia River. There's that whole part of the country. Okay. But in the Midwest, of course, we are the headwaters for the Mississippi, which unfortunately is challenged by one of the biggest wicked problems facing our nation. It's a dead zone, no oxygen in the water off the coasts of Louisiana, Mississippi, and Texas because of the nitrogen that flows out of the Mississippi Farm Belt. We also are the headwaters for the Great Lakes, and guess what? They're not as pristine as we'd like them to be. And we are the headwaters, right? Lake Superior is the beginning of the chain of lakes out the St. Lawrence, and we're the headwaters of that. Not a very big basin for us, but it's a big responsibility. And so we have that responsibility, and I haven't even talked about the Red River of the North, but that, of course, flows all the way to Hudson Bay and runs through one of the most iconic waters in all of Canada, and that's Lake Winnipeg. And we unfortunately export a lot of polluted water up to Canada. I can tell you they're not too happy about that. So we have a big responsibility. We're not just stewards of our water here in Minnesota. We are stewards of water throughout the United States and Canada. All right, I'm going to finish with the last piece. I gave you tons of information. There are five things I personally, my professional opinion, of what would have to happen for the state to actually achieve water sustainability. The first, in terms of protecting water quality and quantity, determine the water balance and revise the permitting. And the state gets an A-minus in this. They are doing this. This is really moving on track. Require pollutant reductions and equity. Bring agriculture to the table in a framework that makes them just as responsible as the stormwater people, just as responsible as the wastewater utilities. How are we doing on that? Not so good. You have to remember, I'm a former professor. Everybody gets grades. Well, the state gets an F on this one. Addressing future contaminants, a D. We're doing our best, but frankly, it's a national problem. It's not something Minnesota can solve on its own. That's the only reason it doesn't get a higher grade. In terms of the interconnectedness, we need to integrate water and land use planning, and I give the state a C. They're trying hard, but we haven't seen the results of that yet. In terms of aligning our policies, which I think is critical to not continually working against each other, F. So we're not doing so well on the critical ones. I can point to all kinds of great things the state is doing, but frankly, we have two Fs on this scorecard. If you brought this home, if your child brought this home from the third grade, you'd be pretty alarmed, wouldn't you? Two Fs, a D and a C, yikes. So we have a long ways to go, but I do think now, okay, I told you I'd end on a high note, right? Okay, so can we get there? I just made it sound like we don't have a chance. Well, it's just the third grade. They're not applying to college yet. So you got some chances. You got some time to improve the grades here. So can we? Yes. We have a clean water fund. No other state has this. Every state is so jealous of us that we have this amazing amount of money dedicated to water. So we have this clean water fund. Let's keep investing in it. We have a governor who's interested in leaving a water legacy. Now, whether you like the governor or not, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, frankly, water is a nonpartisan issue. Maybe it should be a bipartisan issue. It's an all-partisan issue. There's not a single person of any persuasion that doesn't think water is important, because guess what? We all need it. So he wants to leave a water legacy. Let's take advantage of that. And he's having a summit next Saturday. I'm sure most of you are aware of that. And engaging in citizens like yourselves, I call you citizens, most of you are professionals in this field, but I just want to say that we have a perfect, potential perfect storm in Minnesota. We have money, we have political will, and we have an engaged public. And it doesn't get much better than that. I can't think of anything else that would actually result in a positive outcome for Minnesota. We are at a tremendous opportunity crossroads right now. So, yes, I think we can get there. So, I'll stop there. Do imagine a much better future than we have today, and I'll be happy to take your questions. Thanks.
And just because it's so topical, I'd be curious to hear you say more about what Flint teaches us about infrastructure issues and how, when we think about our situation compared to theirs, what we should see.
Yeah, so Flint was an unfortunate perfect storm of a whole bad set of things that occurred. Briefly, they switched their water supply in 2014 from Lake Huron to the Flint River. In doing so, they made a decision. Okay, so they also were in receivership. They were going bankrupt. And so in Michigan, they have this interesting concept where if they declare bankruptcy, the governor appoints an emergency manager. And so Flint was under the management of an emergency manager, not the city council, not the mayor. It was under a person who was there to save money. The sole purpose was to put them back into the black. And so he made the decision to not use corrosion control, which anybody else would have said you automatically would use corrosion control when you move to more corrosive water, which the Flint River is more corrosive. And by the way, one of the reasons it's more corrosive is because of chlorine in the water, chloride in the water. And part of it is industrial, but the other part is road salt. Minnesota has problems with too much road salt getting into our lakes and rivers. And so our water is also gaining in chloride concentration over time. So tuck that in the back of your hat there for a minute. So they made this decision, so they began to use water which corroded pipes. And then it released lead. I won't go into all the chemistry, but it ended up basically mobilizing lead that was kind of protected in the pipes because of layers of calcium carbonate. But it released all that lead, and so suddenly the residents of Flint were drinking lead-laced water. And the highly corrosive water also corroded the distribution pipes as well as the service pipes to the houses. And some of these houses are old and they have lead, copper pipes with lead solder. And so then they began to see children with lead problems coming into clinics. And so they put the two together that suddenly they were having high lead levels in the children and they knew that they'd switched the water supply. So they tested the water and there's a whole bunch of other things that happened. Bad management by the state government. The email trail makes that quite clear. Many people have now lost their jobs over this catastrophe, but of much more concern are the hundreds of children that were exposed to lead. And once you're exposed, it's permanent. So these children are permanently exposed, and some of them are impaired quite a bit. So a tragedy beyond description. Now, could it happen in Minnesota? Certainly we have old pipes, and the trick is to make sure that the water that's running through them doesn't mobilize the contaminants in those pipes. So you want to use anti-corrosive controls. I'm guessing in Minnesota we do, although most of our water supplies are already pretty not that corrosive. But we're adding chloride to our water all the time from our road salt, so we have to be on the lookout for this. Secondly, we have a much stronger and robust public health system in Minnesota, so I don't think it would happen here. But it's also an environmental justice issue where this happened in poor neighborhoods that didn't have the same advocacy that the wealthier neighborhoods have. So it ends up being a very complicated social, economic, as well as environmental toxic problem. Could it happen in Minnesota? Yes. Unlikely. But Flint, if nothing else, has brought home this tremendous tragedy. This has also happened in Chicago, and it's happened in the city of Washington, D.C. It's happened in Newark, other cities in New Jersey, including Newark, and it's happened in Philadelphia. So this is also isn't a new problem. It's one that just kind of it stays local. But Flint made it a big deal because it was so badly managed. It made the front pages thanks to the media. So.
Very good, thank you. There are a bunch of questions here that I'm on nitrates and things I'm gonna try to group a little bit, but maybe to buy a little time, I'm gonna go off topic and see the question. I'm not finding it, but I remember it. The question was, what about Waukesha? What's the Waukesha and the Outer Basin diversion proposed for Waukesha? Why should we care about that, and what does it mean?
That's a great question. So I might not be up on the very latest, but Waukesha community outside of Milwaukee happens to also be outside of the Great Lakes Basin. So the Great Lakes Basin, it runs very narrowly along the edge, the western edge of Lake Michigan, and Waukesha is just outside of that basin boundary. So its watershed is actually the Mississippi River. And the Great Lakes Compact, which all of the Great Lakes states have signed, actually became federal law under George Bush, and is now also party to an international agreement with Quebec and Ontario. And the country of Canada, that no withdrawals of water can leave the basin. So they're basically protecting the Great Lakes. They don't want pipes built to take Great Lakes water and go give it to Arizona or wherever. And so the idea was to protect withdrawals of the Great Lakes. And there's some loopholes here and there, but the biggest thing was if you had a state that had a community that wanted to do a withdrawal for such as Waukesha does, because they have, I'm trying to remember what the contamination is. It's either uranium or arsenic or
radium.
There we go. Both. Okay. Not arsenic, but okay. Uranium produces radon gas. So they've got a problem that they can't fix very easily or very cheaply, and they're really close. They're like 30 miles from Lake Michigan. I mean, it would be very easy for them to get Lake Michigan water and much cheaper than cleaning it. And so they've put in a request to withdraw Lake Michigan water. And for that to be approved, all the Great Lakes governors, as well as the premiers of Ontario and Quebec, have to approve that request. And if any one of them vetoes it, it won't happen. And that was to allow for exceptions, but to protect the compact. Also, anybody who asked for a withdrawal would have to replace the same volume of water, meaning once they treated and did wastewater treatment, they would have to return that water back to Lake Michigan. So basically, no harm, no foul was the concept there. Well, as I understand it, and this is where I'm looking to the audience, when I was in Washington earlier this week, somebody told me that actually it's already been turned down. And I said, I didn't even think Minnesota had voted yet, that the governor hadn't made his decision. But did anybody know if it's...
No,
that was a rumor. I didn't hear that.
There's been no action on it.
Okay, yeah. All the states actually have to rule. And again, if anyone rules against it, then it's dead in the water. But, pun intended. but that's what that's about. It's about the legal right to withdraw water from the Great Lakes.
Well, and then I want to ask a follow-up question that I've heard you answer this before, but these folks haven't. I've heard you say that you think actually the notion that somebody would build a water pipeline to move Great Lakes water to Arizona and California is probably not the issue we should be worrying about because of the enormous cost.
Yeah, I know you started with this whole thing of the next oil, the new oil is going to be water. Water certainly is very expensive, and it's very precious, and so it becomes more and more valuable. And many places in our country need water, and they don't have enough. It turns out it is actually much cheaper for you to either reuse water, re-clean water, repurpose water, than it is to move it. It's heavy. It's very heavy liquid. It takes a lot to move it. It takes a lot of pumps. It takes a lot of electricity to move water huge distances. So it's extremely expensive. So unless there were a situation where it actually proved comparable in expense or less expensive, like Waukesha, it doesn't make a lot of sense in today's world. Now, it's not to say it wouldn't happen in the future, but that's why they have the compact in place, is basically there's this legal structure so that when and if this question comes up, there is a legal structure to manage it. But I also think, although I've talked to many lawyers on this about this, and I actually think it would withstand a legal challenge. But there are lawyers out there that think, no, that actually it's a 50-50, whether if Waukesha were to sue, for instance, would it withstand a legal battle? I don't know. But my sense is that it went through a regional compact, it went through U.S. Congress, it was signed by international treaty. It's hard for me to see how it would not stand a legal challenge, but I'm not a lawyer, so.
Very good. There are a whole lot of questions here about nitrates. And I guess I could group them into the what can be done about nitrates, what can be done about cleaning them out of water, what can be done about to change the tiling practices to sort of reverse that. And maybe I'll ask this one. I haven't heard you say this before, that it isn't just a matter of doing agriculture differently. It might be a matter of growing different things.
Yeah, so, and I'm gonna just go out on a professional limb here, since I don't work for anybody anymore. I can kind of say what I actually think. Not that the university ever tried to keep me quiet, but the only person I answer to now is my husband, so that's pretty good. Nitrates, there's a whole bunch of issues there. So nitrates, can you take them out of water once they're there? Yes, you can. In fact, the city of St. Peter knows this all too well. They built a very expensive, very large nitrate removal system, and it's called reverse osmosis, if you've heard of this, or RO. And the reverse osmosis is essentially an extremely complicated and very fine filtration system that removes the nitrate molecules from the water. Very expensive. And the reason it's so expensive is because it takes so much energy to push the water through those filters. So again, we're back to the energy thing. If you're going to build you could put an RO system in every water supply in the state. Terrific. You'd have the cleanest water on the planet. Terrific. And we'd have to build like 50 more, coal-fired power plants to do it. So there's a trade-off all the time. So it makes a lot more sense to many of us that you would rather prevent the nitrates from getting in the water than to allow the nitrates in the water and then remove them using a very expensive, very complicated, high technology. So to get less nitrates into the system, you want to do a couple of things. You want to use far less fertilizer. The main source of the nitrates is the use of extra fertilizer on growing row crops. There is some additional input from livestock, but that's more the phosphorus side. From the nitrate side, it's mostly the use of fertilizers, of nitrate-based fertilizers. So you want to be smart about fertilizer use. You can apply less and maybe risk getting less of a yield. If you're a farmer, fertilizer's cheap. Nobody says you can't apply as much as you want, and you want to ensure you get every last bushel of corn out of your farm. So we don't have a mechanism to slow that part down. You could put a tax on the fertilizer to try to make it less economically feasible to apply so much. People have looked at that, but the tax would have to be huge because the cost of fertilizer is so cheap. So that actually, if you do the math, that's not a great technique. You could grow something different. So corn, as much of it is, it's so symbolic and iconic of Minnesota. We're number two or number three in the country growing corn. And we're very proud of that, and we should be. The problem with that is that corn uses a lot of water, and it uses a lot of nitrates. It uses a lot of fertilizer. And it's an annual, so you have to apply fertilizer all the time. And it is a really different crop than what we used to grow on our soil, which was small grains and oats and wheat and barley and things of that nature. And they were planted at a different time relative to the water cycle, so the runoff was different. It wasn't nearly as drastic. Corn is kind of like the worst crop from an environmental perspective. Again, I'm just giving you the facts. It's worse from the way the water cycle matched with the plowing and planting and harvesting cycle, and it's the worst relative to the application of fertilizer. So if we went to a different system of cropping, I don't mean every cornfield, I just mean some of the corn. There's maybe 10% of the land, if it were used differently, you would end up fixing the nitrate problem. And that requires, though, 10% of the landowners to say, oh, I guess I'll give up this really wonderful corn crop and I'll grow, clover, And that's not going to happen either without incentives, an economic and social system that will support that switch, because it's not up to the farmers necessarily to fix this. Okay, yes, they are causing pollution that they're not paying to fix. However, it's a bigger problem than they can fix as individuals. It's a system problem. And so I believe that if there were the right policy structures in place, you could actually incentivize just enough change in cropping systems and land use that you could fix this problem.
You put me instantly in mind of Michael Pollan's observation that if you look at the genome of corn over time and how it's changed, and the agricultural practices that have gone along in parallel, you could conclude that corn colonized the human race for its own convenience.
I will simply say that I'm a fan of Michael Pollan's books. They're a very interesting read.
Still on nitrates here. Well, the question was, this is really mostly a problem in drinking water. Nitrate contamination, I think as your map showed, is really a big issue for private wells. And what is the situation in terms of people being able to test their water to be sure it's okay, being able to afford to test their water to make sure it's okay, any kind of support for people who, for one reason or another, have to be on private wells to deal with this?
So that's a great question. So let me first go back to the public water supply. I didn't show maps of the public water supply, but I will say there are many parts of the state where the source of public water actually also is in violation of the nitrate standard. And what those communities have to do is either put in a nitrate removal system or they have to blend their water with cleaner water so that they dilute out the nitrate that's delivered to your homes. So it's not just a private well problem, although it's more severe in the private wells than it is in the public water supply, since we have measurements and we keep on top of the problem. And then, of course, the communities are required by law to fix the problem. If you are using private well water on your own land, nobody says you have to test it. Nobody says you can't drink it. Nobody says anything. Your private well water is not regulated hardly at all, which is both good if you're a land rights person, and it's not so good if actually you're not educated on the fact that your well water could actually be highly contaminated, and there's no one to tell you unless you go find out yourself. So there are ways to get it tested. You can even do just a litmus test kind of thing. You can go to like Home Depot or Menards, and they have water, it's just like a pH paper, like a litmus test, just to see if you're like anywhere in trouble. Now, if you're really concerned and want to know the numbers, I would go to your county health department, and every county has a health department, and they may refer you to the state lab, or they may actually do the testing themselves, but they will do that testing, and it might be $5. We're not talking about a big expense. But the county health departments are the place to start, and they're in the phone book, they're in Google, you can find them. The other thing about nitrates is because we know their main source, especially if you're in a rural area and you've got nitrates in your well, and you're in a farming area, it's highly likely that you have more than nitrates. You probably have pesticides as well. And so you may want to be concerned about that. Those tests are more expensive, but nitrate is a big marker. If you have a nitrate problem, you probably have a pesticide problem. If you don't have a nitrate problem, you probably don't have a pesticide problem. But if you're concerned, if you have children in the house, if you are a health nut, whatever reason motivates you, you can get almost anything tested for. It just will cost you more money, and you may have to go to an outside lab, but every lab that does testing for the state is certified, so you're getting a consistent analysis across the state.
How many people in the house are on private wells? Let's see, hands. A few. We are for the first time, and we had our well. I mean, there was a sort of basic transaction test when we bought the place. It said that it didn't have a lot of fecal coliform in it, I think. But then our township arranged a bulk purchase thing for people to get the whole list tested. I don't think including phthalates, but a bunch of pesticides. And
notice how well he pronounced that. Next, we're going to see if you can spell it.
I think even with the bulk buying discount, was it $300, Sally? $400? It was a bunch. Question about the dead zone. Is it still getting worse every year?
I wanted to mention that. So you said nitrates are mostly a concern around public health. Certainly in Minnesota, that's what we focus on because it's a public health problem here in the state. However, nitrates are the cause, the primary cause, of the dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico, which I'm sure you've all heard about. Yes, the dead zone continues to increase, not decrease. Sometimes it stays the same. Depends on whether we've had drought years or we've had lots of rain in the Mississippi River Basin, because then it delivers more nitrate or less nitrate to the Gulf. But Minnesota is responsible for approximately 7 or 8% of the nitrate that causes the dead zone. So we're not an insignificant player. There's 32 states along the Mississippi, and we're 7% of that input in just one of those 32 states. So we contribute quite a bit, is what I'm saying, kind of out of proportion to other states.
And of that contribution, isn't about 90% of it from the Minnesota River watershed?
Oh, I love an educated guy. That's great. Yes, 90% of our 8% contribution is coming from the Minnesota River Valley. Yes, that's correct. So the dead zone continues to grow. The latest figure was that this the 2015 dead zone was one of the largest ever. But all of the nutrient reduction plans that the states have talked about, and we have a nutrient reduction plan that's focused on reducing our nitrate to the Gulf, but we haven't implemented it yet. So we continue to see the dead zone grow. This year it was likened to the size of Massachusetts. So it's a pretty big area in the Gulf, about 5,000 square miles.
Well, and the tie back would be that, comparing the two watersheds, the Minnesota would be the one that would be far more burdened by the tiling practices and soil runoff and siltation and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about the Minnesota River, it's the entire basin is essentially farmed. There's not anything else to kind of dilute the impact like there is in the other parts of the major, you know, the St. Croix Basin or the Upper Mississippi Basin. Right. But you take a state like Iowa, where the whole state is pretty much farmed, and they have 25 million pigs. Their population's only 6 million. 25 million pigs in the state of Iowa. Isn't that something?
That'd be 4 pigs per person, I think.
Yeah, it's just astonishing. No. Anyway, they are like 25% of the nitrate contribution to the Gulf. So if you want to look to a worse player, definitely Iowa comes to mind.
We have an Iowa question here in the card here.
Iowa lawsuit?
Yeah, I think it was. It was the question about what is Iowa doing about tiling and a reference to litigation. I think they're talking about the Des Moines Water
Works. Yeah, so all of us in the water world, particularly those of us that are worried about agriculture and water quality, are looking at this interesting situation that has arisen in Iowa. Now, I love Iowa. I went to school at Grinnell College. I love Grinnell. And I lived in Iowa for 4 years. They were four tremendous, wonderful years. But they do a lot of farming, as you know. And the city of Des Moines is where much of the population is, and the city of Des Moines has something called the Des Moines Water Works, and it gets its water from the Raccoon River, which is a major tributary to the Des Moines River, which empties into the Mississippi. And the Raccoon River is mostly draining upstream counties that have lots of, well, basically 100% corn production and pig production. And they are similar to Minnesota in that they have drainage districts that run along the county lines. So the counties are also the drainage districts. They have tile draining, just like we have in Minnesota. But what Des Moines did was about 10 years ago, they had to build a nitrate removal plant, a huge nitrate removal plant, because the Raccoon River, draining all of that farm fields and those livestock areas, they were well above the nitrate standard. So they had to build a nitrate removal system, a reverse osmosis system, to the tune of about $100 million. That cost, that capital cost, was passed on to their consumers. And they noticed that the nitrate problems were getting worse, not better, over the last several years, and their population is growing. And so they said, we're going to have to build a new nitrate removal system to the tune of about another $125 million unless we just had less nitrates. So the CEO of the utility, Bill Stowe, who some of you have probably heard speak, he and his board, they decided that they would actually force this issue from a legal standpoint. And so they sued three of the drainage districts, three counties. So row crop agriculture is exempted from the Clean Water Act. Individual farmers are, and the tile drains are. But what he did was he said, this is no longer row crop agriculture. We're talking about a collection ditch managed by a drainage authority. It's an outflow, just like a sewer outfall, just like a stormwater outflow, and it should be regulated under the Clean Water Act. It's not exempt. It's now an outfall. It's not runoff from a farm. Interesting concept. So he's got a different legal angle than any other lawsuit that's ever been brought around this issue. So he's basically saying they're in violation of the Clean Water Act. They should be a permitted point source under the Clean Water Act. And he only sued three counties where 100% of their outflow is coming from farmland. It's a huge contribution of nitrates. So they have an irrefutable data as to the source of the nitrates to their drinking water system. He didn't sue the whole state, he didn't sue upstream. He sued three that he knew for sure. So they have an interesting case. We're all watching this case because it would be a huge precedent no matter how the courts were to rule. It'll get appealed all the way to the Supreme Court if the various sides of this decide to take it to the Supreme Court. And it pits some very interesting people to be bedfellows that normally wouldn't be bedfellows. For example, the US EPA probably doesn't want this court case to win. They don't want Des Moines to win. They'd have to implement a permit system for all of the drainage districts in the country. And they really don't want to do that. That's what led to the exemption in the first place. So they're kind of like, ugh. The Department of Agriculture is like, oh, terrible idea. And then you have many states and many conservation groups and water quality groups, advocates saying, finally, somebody is saying, make agriculture pay just the way we make stormwater and wastewater utilities pay. So it's an interesting case. They may settle out of court and it will stop being such a cool thing to talk about. But we're kind of hoping that they don't settle out of court. I really love to see this actually push people to have to come up with a better solution. Ron is speechless.
You know, I guess I've never heard anybody phrase it quite that way before. That basically, if this suit were to succeed, EPA would have to basically issue a point source discharge permit for.
Right. So under the Clean Water Act, every single point source has to have a permit through the National Permit System, and it's a huge amount of work. And there's compliance, and there's monitoring, and there's all this work. And although as much as we would like to see the agricultural community to be accountable for the pollution that they create, the burden on the permitting system, a direct permit, would be huge. And that's why, and Congress said that. Congress said this is burdensome, and that's when they exempted row crop agriculture back in the 80s as a result of several lawsuits back then. This lawsuit's a little different because they have a unique system in Iowa which makes it kind of perfect for this lawsuit. But a lot of people are like, I'm not so sure we want them to actually be regulated as a point source. I would actually, my personal preference would be to see agriculture regulated as a, not a non-point source. There is so much language in the Clean Water Act. That's not a legal term. But regulated as an area source. So a collective of polluters regulated as one. And I think there are ways to do that. But that's my personal preference.
I want to say to those of you who've sent questions up, this is quite a challenge. The questions are so good and they're so varied that it is really difficult to group them. But I'm going to group two together here that are both sort of about Gitche-Gumee. The first question says, Lake Superior is impaired. Tell us more. The second question is, will RAPS, the WRAPS approach, get us a mercury TMDL on the St. Louis River, big tributary of Gitche-Gumee, of course.
Okay, I'll go to the first one first. So yes, Lake Superior, the Minnesota waters of Lake Superior are considered impaired because of the Duluth Superior Harbor. That's the main reason that it was painted yellow and orange in the slide of impaired waters. In fact, we have a major Superfund site that's undergoing restoration and cleanup, which is a good thing. But yes, the Duluth Harbor is pretty has had its insults over the years. So it's got problems from everything from bacteria to toxic pollutants to PAHs, et cetera. But the restoration of the St. Louis River and the harbor is underway, so there's a lot of good things happening up there. There's also some bacteria violations on the tributaries that come in into Lake Superior along the North Shore. And those are, I think it's a little less clear what's causing them. To some extent, it's wildlife. It's, you know, deer and geese and whatnot in those little trout streams. But it's also a result of some uncontrolled straight-line sewage, individual septic tanks, which are also being addressed, but it's really hard to track those down and fix them. And so they're, because that's all bedrock up there, you know, the Canadian Shield, it's really back when those cottages were built along the North Shore, any of those summer cottages, they really had just straight line pipes to Lake Superior. And those have caused some problems over the years. But again, that's being addressed. So there, yeah, Lake Superior has its challenges. It's not the whole lake. I don't mean to say that the largest lake in the world is impaired because of Minnesota. It's the near shore regions and the harbor in Minnesota. And the second question had to do with
St. Louis River and a TMDL.
And mercury. So
mercury TMDL.
So the state has a mercury TMDL, and that's a blanket, basically an agreement between the state and the U.S. EPA that basically they both acknowledge that every water in the state probably has an impairment due to mercury, but it's not practical to say, oh, well, we have 100% impaired waters. That would be it's not a useful thing to say when the mercury pollution, 90% of that pollution is coming from outstate. So it's not something the state can do. However, the St. Louis River has a higher, more than just that background level of mercury. So they have a special TMDL that's focused on the St. Louis River. It's been very contentious how to go about implementing the cleanup of the St. Louis River and to get an agreement on that. And the reason is that it's complicated jurisdictionally. You've got Wisconsin and Minnesota. You have the tribes who have a lot of jurisdiction over the waters of the St. Louis River as it flows through to the harbor and to the estuary. And so there's a lot of interjurisdictional tension around fixing that particular situation. And actually, the current status is, I believe, the state is moving forward on a remedy for the cleanup of the St. Louis. And I am aware that the tribes are not too happy with that, but I don't know the details, and I probably shouldn't speak too far at a turn on that one.
You know, I want to go back just for a minute to the straight pipe thing. Because when I think about the surprising statistics I've ever learned about Minnesota, this was one of them, but it's out of date. And if anybody would know the current figure, it's going to be Deb Swackhamer. I remember being at a legislative committee hearing where it was estimated that, this was back when the Water Legacy Amendment was being framed, that there were 65,000 failing septic systems in Minnesota. And of those, more than half were straight pipe into the creek systems, where people basically flush the toilet and it goes in the creek. Do you any idea how that's changed?
Yes, it's improved considerably, because when that number was really put together, first of all, the numbers are extremely uncertain. It's really kind of word of mouth, and different counties report different things, and some counties don't report at all, and nobody goes out and checks. And I mean, because you're talking about, you know, personal land rights, you get into all sorts of issues. And the state made a concerted effort, and they also had clean water funding from the Clean Water Fund to go and really address this issue, because that's really pretty embarrassing, that more than 50% of the...
West Virginia. Sorry.
It was really a bad number.
My father's from West Virginia.
And it kind of got everybody's attention. So there were resources put to fixing this, and the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency put resources and people towards this. And I have seen numbers that are down more like the under 20%. But again, these numbers are incredibly uncertain. But definitely, they've made huge progress on fixing most of these straight line systems, because they kind of know where the problems are. So they kind of quietly go in and try to fix those. There are some communities where they don't have the wherewithal to build, say, a community treatment system. So they have individual systems that are in failure. And there are a couple of these really tough situations where that community, you know, small community of, say, 300 people, they don't have the money to build a water treatment plant to connect their houses to, or individuals to fix. And actually, the state doesn't want them to fix the septics. They want to put them on a community treatment system. So Some of these things have to be worked out individually, sometimes at the community level, sometimes at the personal level, but the state has been whittling away at that. So the latest number I've heard is less than 20%, but I'll simply say there's actually not strict accounting of this.
Very good. Thanks for taking a stab at it. Somewhat to my surprise, I see five questions about the Farm Bill, a subject that I should study more, but I can barely bring myself to do so. The question is, what could be done in the federal Farm Bill to alleviate some of the issues we've been talking about on the Minnesota land and waterscape?
So that's a really huge question, but let me first just say that I talked about this misalignment of our policies. So if you have one policy that says go this way and another policy that goes this way, they're going to run into each other and cause problems. The Farm Bill and water policy, water policy for the most part is done at the state level. The state has responsibility for its own waters, and the Clean Water Act is just a framework for the states to work from. The states have primacy when it comes to water resources. But the Farm Bill is federal, of course. And the Farm Bill has all sorts of policies that encourage the growing commodity crops, and corn and soybeans are two of those five commodities, because they get all kinds of benefits from the Farm Bill. They get they used to get direct subsidies, now they get indirect subsidies, they get crop insurance, they get lots of benefits and encouragement to continue to grow corn and soybeans on their land. And that's understandable. But the problem is that the more you encourage the use of marginal land to grow corn and soybeans, the more you will get erosion, the more you will get nitrate runoff, et cetera. And so the Farm Bill encourages the misuse of marginal land in terms of producing more crops to make a business, to make your business work. So there are... If you're a farmer, you know, you're up against these huge pressures. And the other thing that was pointed out to me is an interesting concept. So most people in the private sector, if you're a private businessman, you get to decide the price of your goods. Yeah. You know, you've got supply and demand, market things working in to set what you're going to sell things for. And if you're a farmer, the price of corn, you don't determine what you're going to sell your corn for. The markets do. I mean, the Farm Bill essentially decides the futures market. But you, as an individual, not at all. You don't get a chance to do that. So you're at the mercy of a whole bunch of other things that are going on with our federal policy. And that gave me a little bit more sympathy for the fact that not only are they private business people, but they don't get to set the price of their good. It's a complicated, and that's why I think working more with the supply chain is more realistic, because guess who helps set those prices? It's Cargill and ADM and the purchasers of their goods. So it's a very complicated system. But back to the Farm Bill. There are a couple of things the Farm Bill could do. You could, for instance, and I'll throw this out there as an idea that a good friend of mine, Sean Schottler, has thrown out as an idea. So it's not my idea, but it resonated with me. Right now, we pay 62%, we, the taxpayer, pay 62% of the cost of crop insurance. Farmers pay whatever the difference is, 38% of crop insurance costs when they have a claim. We pay 63% of their crop insurance. That's a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
Hey, so they can take risks. That's, you know, if someone else is paying your premium, hey, why not? So what if you were to say to the farming community, we'll pay 50% of your crop insurance if you implement these 10 BMPs on your land? Otherwise, no. And I'm sorry, we'll pay 62% if you do the BMPs. For every BMP you don't put on your land, we take away your crop insurance. So the if you don't want to do anything differently, you get 50%. But if you're a good farmer and do these BMPs, we'll pay 62% of your crop insurance through taxpayers' dollars. And he says, make an incentive that they can work with as a business person. And I thought, that's a very clever idea. Now, you'd have to do all the math to figure out if 50 is the right number or 48 is the right number. But basically, work within the Farm Bill to incentivize better management of the land. So that's an example. The other thing would be is to have more rewards for organic farming. Right now, organic farmers don't get nearly the benefits as the commodity farmers. More benefits for less fertilizer use. There are things the Farm Bill, they drive so much behavior. So the Farm Bill is where a lot of change could occur. But right now, the Farm Bill is at about 90 degrees to clean water.
Do you get a lot of pushback from the Farm Bureau and the Growers Associations?
I'll simply say that when I was the director of the Water Resources Center, there were many letters on file in the president's office at Morrill Hall on campus that called for my ouster, because I was outspoken about water quality and agriculture.
I've been handed a note that says we're over time, but I want to close with two quick questions. If you were starting your research career now, what would you like to study?
Wow, that's great. You're going to be disappointed in the answer. So I actually, chemistry was always the love of my life. I applied it to environmental systems, and I've very much enjoyed that tremendously. But if I were to start all over, say I had a second chance to go back and do chemistry for something else, the idea of food chemistry, I love to cook. I'm kind of an amateur chef, and the whole concept of food chemistry really kind of is very exciting. And then there's forensic chemistry. I watch CSI religiously, so there's all that too. So chemistry is just, it's terrific. You can use it for so many things.
Better living, I think, through chemistry.
Yes, better living through chemistry.
All right, here's the last one. What can the average Minnesota resident do to be a good water steward? Who asked that question? Good for you.
Thank you. single most important thing? Okay. If you're going to be effective, I mean, you all should learn, you should all, you know, participate. You are, you're here. I don't have to say all that to you guys. Talk to your neighbors and family. I'm going to run through all those kind of things you can think of yourself. Know where your water comes from, where it goes. I've said those things. I'd say the single most important thing you can do is to promote good water policy at the state level, and that is to talk to your legislator. Minnesota has, this is true, we have more legislators per capita than any other state. We have a huge number of legislators per population. We have more legislators than per capita than any other state. It's unbelievable. Look it up on Wikipedia. And as a result, we have legislators. I mean, you can talk to them. You can go visit them. They'll answer their telephone. And I'm telling you, I've had legislators say, I get a phone call from somebody. Okay, somebody writes it down. I get a phone call on the same topic 2 days, you know, again, from a second person. It goes into a file. I create a file. I get a third phone call. Okay, I'll go up to five. You get five phone calls on a subject, just five. Five interested constituents. And they go and study it. They go find out what the heck's going on. Why did five whole people, that's all it took was five, a threshold, to get a legislator interested in a topic, research the topic, make some phone calls, and then develop a position. You can influence your legislator more than you have any idea. You absolutely have tremendous control, you have tremendous influence over your local legislators. So I really encourage you to talk to them.
How many people in the room knew that Minnesota had more legislators per capita than any other? I see one hand. It might have been, okay. See, this is why we love having you speak, Deb.
I know really strange, odd facts.
All the great subject matter, but then these interesting sidelines, too. Thank you so very, very much.
Thank you
it's
for having
been a
me.
Pleasure.
Great. I'm happy to hang around if you have more questions.